Team Secret up against Cloud9. Obviously, Secret taking the first game of the series. This is the Mars TV Dota 2 League. I'm OD Pixel and I will be joined by Gods for this game.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
So, let's get young Master Gods on the line.
Dire team pick.
Doo-doo's give him an old... Yeah, let's get him on the line as we're ready to go. Gods, are you there, my friend?
I'm here. I apologize for game one. But
that's
all
right. We forgive you, Gods. So, anyway, did you manage to catch them at game one? Did you watch it?
Yes, I watched all of game one. It was a lot of fun.
It was indeed. And we're seeing it again. So, Tusk, this hero, right, it was going into this series 13-1. Obviously, last game, poor old Notel, it was a loss for the hero, so it's the second loss of the tournament. But still, they pick it up first again, which, I mean, Secret, they're going to be able to get Artur his Shadow Fiend. I mean, is this the smartest move from Cloud9, do you think? Do you think Tusk is really that powerful that, yeah, game one was a bit of a mishap, they can do something spectacular in game two?
Yeah, I don't think game one was lost on the back of this hero, and it's something which, if they want to get their hands on, they probably want to be first picking. Otherwise, Secret get Tusk with the Shadow Fiend or something else. 69, another team who's going to be first picking Shadow Fiend. So, as far as what's left in the pool, I think it's one of the better heroes to be first picking, based on this tournament's metagame, at least.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's kind of, I wouldn't say come out of nowhere, but it's definitely been much more prevalent this tournament than in any other that we've seen recently. And Secret, well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. They're going to be able to get that Quap pickup as well. And the question is, now Cloud9 with the Tusk, obviously in the last game we saw them opt for heroes like the Dazzle, like the PL, which are still both available in the pool. I mean, do you see Cloud9 going for just a similar lineup again?
I think they may stay away from the PL, or at least not be looking to pick it up. The Dazzle works really well with the Tusk, because you're snowballing in close, you're hitting the stun, the ice shards. It's really easy to get the damage output from the Shadow Wave, and Weave just gives you a nice like defensive ability to kind of back up the aggression that Tusk delivers. So I think Dazzle's a good hero that synergizes really well with the Tusk, which is where Empire were picking Tusk and Dazzle as their opening two picks a lot, but what do I know? They go PL.
Classic. Yeah, he loves the hero. It didn't work out in the first game, they want to make it happen. They really do. The same two opening picks as they had in game one, and the ban's pretty much similar as well. This time, Cloud9, they do take away Zai's clockwork. I mean, we did see Zai cause a lot of havoc for the side of C9 in game one on that clock.
The big problem with the Tusk, like this Tusk PL thing, is if you're not willing to aggro Tri-Lane, which you're probably not going to do when you have Tusk and PL on the same team, because PL wants the safe lane farm, Secret are going to dominate the lanes. Queen of Pain in the safe lane can zone out most offlaners. SF in the mid should do just fine. So I feel like that's where the PL pick maybe is not so much a vulnerability, but kind of pushes you into this direction where your PL is going safe lane. You're not going to pressure the Secret safe lane itself, so... Secret know they have all the room in the world to do what they want with their own jungle and with their support movements.
Indeed, the bans as well from Cloud9, they're going to ban out the Naga Siren. I mean, we saw the Kuroki Naga in the first game, and it was pretty spectacular. You know, he was able to do so much in lane. His item progression was pretty insane as well. There were some massive songs setting up, you know, the positioning of S4 and Arteezy. So if they could have grabbed it, I wouldn't have been surprised if Secret took the Naga again, because they can do some magical things with that hero.
Yeah, he ended up getting even more farm than Zai did back in game one. So that's something where Secret, you really never know what's coming your way. They seem to get prioritized spreading the farm a lot more between their supports and stuff. Some games you'll see Puppy with a huge amount of farm when he's playing like his jungling Chen. Other games it's Kuro with a lot of farm. Sometimes it'll be Zai on something like a Brood, which gets a huge amount of farm priority. Speaking of Brood, still in the pool, and that to me is maybe a hero that you could be looking to fourth pick if you're Secret and you see that Cloud9 don't have a good answer to a Brood pick.
I know that is certainly true here. And, well, Secret now, with this third pick, will they go for the same kind of draft as we saw in the first game? It would involve either picking up, well, I guess it would be the Naga or the CM, and obviously last game the CM was final pick, so probably we'll see something a bit different, I'd imagine, come out from Secret now.
Yeah, the Naga and Clockwork got banned, so as far as offlaners go, the big two that stand out to me is like your Bristleback and Brood, but maybe it's going to be more towards a support pickup here, which is Kuro Rubick still in the pool, Otherwise, you're looking at some of the puppy heroes like Dazzle, which they really like Dazzle themselves. And if they take Dazzle, it also denies it from Cloud9. Since I mentioned Dazzle does work really well with the Tusk, but Bounty Hunter comes out. That's a fun little hero to watch.
That is, and it was also a hero that was banned out against them in Game 1. And, I mean, Bounty Hunter as well. I'll have a look at his old stats, but it's got to be pretty impressive. I feel like we haven't seen him much this tournament, though, have we?
Not that frequently. Tusk has been the more prioritized kind
of Tusk, yeah.
Four-position hero slash... I mean, I guess Tusk has also been run as a offlane hero. We've seen Vici Gaming run it in the kind of offlane role, but... I think the Tusk and Bounty Hunter kind of fill a similar niche where there's this just annoying utility hero that offers a lot of kind of ganking mid-game fight potential, so you don't see the two together all too much, but Secret are kind of maybe using it as a pseudo-replacement for the Tusk, although it won't be Zai probably playing. It's probably going to be in the four role for Kuro.
Yeah, indeed. I'll just have a look. Yeah, we've seen it. It's been picked up three times so far in the finals. One game, in fact, the only game that it actually won the game was when No-Tail picked up for Cloud9. Other than that, it did lose the other two times. So we'll see what Secret can do with it. They've not played it themselves yet during this LAN. And Cloud9, they're going to pick up the Spirit Breaker as the third pick.
Okay, so Spirit Breaker for Bone7 most likely, although it could be a support as well, but this is a lot of fighting potential. They've got three melee heroes, PL kind of going to be the more farm-oriented hero, but everyone else Cloud9 is drafting is probably going to be looking to be able to fight early, go for early kills, and just take all those little kind of skirmishes around the map, because that's what Spirit Breaker and Tusk are great at. You run at your opponents, you snowball in, you have the charge also as like an AoE stun to go through multiple heroes, and then all very tanky. Spirit Breaker, one of the highest effective HPs in the game. Tusk, super durable as well. These are hard heroes to bring down and great heroes to have against Bounty Hunter.
Oh, and we're going to see the Darkseer come out. So it's going to be that old kind of Darkseer bounty, perhaps dual offlane at the start. Yeah. It's going to be very annoying for EE to farm against if that happens to be what the lane situation ends up as. So, well, Secret, they grabbed that. And I mean, I think Cloud9 will be happy with the Spirit Breaker. I mean, Secret actually banned it out against them. And Cloud9, they're going to bring the Zeus back. Zeus, he's definitely one of those heroes that's... There was a point in time where he was like top tier pick and ban. He's fallen off a little bit, but still can be very, very strong in the mid lane, especially kind of contesting for farm with heroes like the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, this is going to be a very high priority on Fata's farm here, I think. And this is where I think Cloud9 are kind of going away. Well, they want to have a big, good, like a 10 to 15 minute fighting unit around the Zeus, Spirit Breaker, and Tusk, but they're not going to be looking to find lots of early ganks with a roaming Zeus or anything like that. And I think they know it matches up well with what Arteezy's doing, because Arteezy's not going to be leaving the mid lane. He's not going to be roaming around, so Fata knows he can sit mid, get his farm on, and just look to play towards the mid to late game, match up to what Arteezy has with his farm.
Indeed. Now, final ban for the side at Cloud9. Looking at Secret's draft, they do still need what I'd imagine to be the puppy hero. Would it be Kuro who's going to play the Bounty Hunter, do you think?
Yeah, this will be Kuro Bounty Hunter and puppy hero for Secret. And for Cloud9, probably looking for that Misery 5-position support.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, the Dazzle was banned out then. Yeah, the Dazzle. I think Cloud9 would have been quite happy in terms of getting their hands on. I mean, does anyone else kind of come to mind for you for these last two picks for both sides?
I think Crystal Maiden's still a really good option for Secret, especially. They ran it in game one. It worked out nicely. It really gives Arteezy a little boost to his mana pool. It works great with all four of these heroes who are fairly mana dependent, so having just one or two points in the aura can really benefit them. I think the big thing with Secret's draft is this Darkseer pick works so nicely against the three melee heroes. Iron Shell Vacuum is going to be very potent, and making illusions of PL always something that can really be handy in a team fight. So I think the Darkseer pick was something which fits this draft great, sets up the AoE combos of Queen of Pain and Shadow Fiend, but also counters the Cloud9 draft really well. And there's the CM Bam. Secret not going to get their hands on Crystal Maiden, so we'll see what they have in mind instead for Puppy.
Yeah, it's understandable as well. Puppy had a pretty spectacular performance on it in Game 1. And as you said, there's a lot of heroes on this team that would be very happy with that extra bit of mana regeneration in the laning stage. And we'll see what they do decide to opt for elsewise. I mean, I guess they could kind of go rather greedy here. Because, I mean, the Queen of Pain... I mean, are they going to pick someone for the jungle, or do you feel that would be just going too far? 5 seconds.
I'm thinking it's... a little on the greedy side, but they could get away with it just because Cloud9 do not have heroes where they can pressure the lanes with. They don't have anyone who's going to be looking to push fast towers. They don't have, I guess, Tusk can kind of roam as a support. We saw it a bit more likely they go something more, yeah, more laning presence. Keeper of the Light comes out. It seems Puppy's sticking to like a kind of set hero pool for himself, the Keeper of the Light, the CM, the Dazzle, and then the jungling heroes like Chen and Enchantress and Enigma. So sticking to his hero pool rather than going with something more standard.
Okay, indeed. The Kotal, another one of those heroes that a lot of teams are favouring at the moment. Now Cloud9 with their final pick. What is going to be their support of choice? Against these heroes like the Kotal, I feel like they need a lot of control. Something like a Lion, I feel, would be quite nice to slot in here.
Lion would be great. It suits Misery. The other hero that kind of comes to mind, although not really a Cloud9 hero, is Disruptor. Disruptor lanes really well against Darkseer with the Glimpse. The Static Storm is great in a teamfight against Queen of Pain, Darkseer, and all that. Other than that, the only other hero I see being maybe possible is a Witch Doctor who adds some heal and sustain against the Keeper of the Light Blast. But outside of those three, I'm not sure what Cloud9 would go for. It's probably just going to be a standard 5-position support, and I think the Lion has been such a go-to for Misery so many times that... I'm just wondering, that Lion against Darkseer Bounty Hunter is a bit weak, and they actually get... Okay, so they get a bit tankier and more durable, which is the Bane.
Yeah. Yes.
The reason is just holds up against the Bounty Hunter. The squishy Lion does.
Okay, indeed, and here we go, getting ourselves into the second game of this best of three. Secret leading the way with the first game win. Cloud9, they need to do something spectacular this game. And I mean, looking at the drafts, who are you kind of favoring? Who do you feel has got like the more robust and stable draft going into this game, Gods?
I think Secret's draft very stable. They've proven that the Shadow Fiend Queen of Pain opening has worked ever since DAC when they first started pulling it out. And I think for Secret, they're in their comfort zone. Everyone's got a hero. They've played a lot. I mean, Secret kind of draft from each player seems to have a hero pool of like 4 to 6 heroes that they kind of stick to. But this to me is some of their stronger ones with the Arteezy Shadow Fiend, S4 and the mid game Queen of Pain tempo controlling. I think for the most part, it's better draft. And this PL is going to be under a lot of pressure in the game like we saw last game. Secret was.
Indeed, and here we go. I mean, the question is as well, in the first game, we saw Arteezy absolutely dominate the mid lane against Farta. He was on the invoker. Oh no!
You saw that dust as well?
I did.
Oh dear.
Oh.
That's...
Lotel, please.
he was trying to swap the wards, I'm guessing. Yeah, he had the wards in the wrong slot.
Oh dear. Okay. Well, no one saw that.
Shake it off.
No one
Shake
saw
off.
That. Shake it off. Yeah. He literally did, and it's gone. It's gone now. But yeah, let's get ourselves into this. So yeah, mid lane. Arteezy, he was able to dominate against the Invoker. This game, though, Fada should be able to, you know, give him a bit more of a hard time being on the Zeus, shouldn't he?
I think more than anything, they're just going to be trading. Like, Zeus is actually not really an early game dominating hero. He just sits there and farms. He does a very similar thing to Shadow Fiend, which is, I think, where... This matchup will be better because Zeus doesn't get outlaned like we saw in Invoker, where it was like 25 CS to 9. So I think it'll be an more even matchup, but it's not going to be a matchup where we see kills unless supports start ganking, which could well happen from a Bounty Hunter.
Indeed. And we're going to see the side of Cloud9. They're going to head up here for the top rune. And looks like Secret, they want to secure this bottom one. And they've actually got a bit of a wraparound here onto PL. I mean, can they do something onto EE? They don't really have the control to. EE's yet to skill, and he might need to use the doppelganger here. He's going to try and give it the old runaway. And there we go, indeed. Just ensuring that he can get himself right out. But, yeah, here we go. Into the game. Bounty rune secured by Arteezy, secured by Zeus. So both the mid laners getting themselves a nice little boost. Puppy blocking up for the side of Secret at the moment. Big Daddy doing it for the side of Cloud9. Looks like they'll be able to get themselves a fairly even start here in this mid lane. And lane-wise otherwise, so on your off lane, the fact that you have got this Bone 7 Spirit Breaker, how do you feel he's going to be able to do against the S4 Quap and the Puppy Kotal combo?
He should be able to get a lot of experience out of lane, but I don't see him getting much farm. He doesn't want to go up to go for last hits because that's where S4 just beats him down with the Shadow Strike Harass. So I think more than anything, Bone 7 just looking to get as much XP as possible out of this lane and then probably team up with someone like the Tusk and try to get some ganks and kills on Arteezy.
And there we go. Yeah, the Illuminate's just flying through. The daggers as well. Ticking Bone 7 down a bottom lane. Zai just trying to assert his dominance there, playing as aggressive as possible. And I mean, this combination of the Bounty Hunter and the Darkseer, it's going to be a bit of a nightmare for E to farm against.
Yeah, Misery's going to do his best to keep tabs of Kuro, find out where he is in the trees always. But generally speaking, not going to be easy for him. They are bringing in the Tusk here. They've got sentries and dust. Crew in trouble upon
him. There we go. They're going to try for first blood, getting the illusions out as well. He's only level one, so he hasn't got the spirit dancing. Kuroki, he's going to have the arm shards coming out. They will block him enough. That's going to be first blood there.
Zai switched himself. Zai made a big mistake there. He had to save. I guess he meant to iron shell himself, I think, and miss. I don't know how it happened, but he made a big misclick there. And when he surged himself rather than surging off the bounty hunter, that would have definitely saved his life.
But an unfortunate play there for Secret.
Yeah. It's nice seeing these things because it reminds all the viewers that even the best players in the world, all these players are probably in the top 20, top 30 in the world individually, and they still make mistakes that you wouldn't expect them to make. Charge mid. Cancel.
Pine 7 was looking for 7. He's not going to be content going that deep. He'll be able to get himself double damage, though. He's going to be able to secure it, in fact, if he wants that far to get that. No, he's going to take it for himself and head back up to the top lane to deal with S4. I mean, the farm so far, looking across the map, Secret looking just a slightly bit healthier, but it's still pretty even. It's just the main difference being that EE is obviously having a harder time in this lane than S4 is in his own.
Yeah, but I'm going to go for another charge. He's using the tree line really well, so he's going to catch Arteezy by surprise, but Arteezy's positioning at the tower is just... Oh, he got the bash on the first hit!
Second bash!
17%.
17%.
Yeah. No talking. That's some RNG. The charge into an insta bash, man. This game has just been a clown fest from the get go.
It has, and when the game goes clowny, there's always one team that's going to come out on top. And well, Cloud9 2-0 at the moment, 3 minutes in. And the fact of the mid lane, this is going so much better for C9 than game one was. You know, Fada's able to keep himself on even levels with the RTZ Shadow Fiend farm. So things looking a lot better for Cloud9 this game than they did in the first one.
Yeah, this is pretty good for them. The laning's still not great. Like, if you look at the actual CSs, it's only really the Zeus who's matching up in the mid lane. The PL's slightly behind the safe lane Queen of Pain as far as farm goes. And off lane is Darkseer's actually getting farm while Spirit Breaker's getting nothing. But Spirit Breaker makes up for that with kills. This hero's not meant to get farm out of the lane. He's meant to be going for kills instead.
Oh, look at the courier. Can Kuroki do this here? Oh, they're trying to juke it out. He's one more hit.
That's nicely played. Can he find it again?
Oh, hello. Look, Big Daddy's coming in and he's found the dust onto Kuroki, and Kuroki could be in trouble now. He's going to get caught out by Fata as well. There's going to be another lightning bolt coming down on his head if needed. The snowball's going to be enough to finish it off with the Arc Lightning. And again, Cloud9 finding some tasty little pickoffs, and Fata being involved in 2 kills so far.
That was really nice. He microed the courier over the trees before the bounty even attacked it. Fata, to me, it's something rare, like, to kind of comment about a mid player, but he micros the courier better than any mid player I've seen. I've seen him where he's just, like, camped the courier by the tier 3 tower and waited to go meet it with his hero rather than bring it out to prevent courier sniping. I never see Fata get his courier sniped. He is just so good at avoiding it.
Indeed, and once again, living up to that bottom lane, EE needs to be careful, keeping himself very low because of the harassment from Zion, as you were saying earlier, Zai. Level 4 at the moment, looking pretty healthy. Bone 7, leaving the top lane, wanting to try and help find something down here. Kuroki going in, but they've got the dust again, and they might be able to bring him down. They've got a charge if needed. EE's going to throw the lance down onto Zai. Ice Shards will trap both of them. The snowball of the charge coming onto Zai. The Thundercross Wrath will bring down the bounty hunter. They should be able to find Zai as well there. And again, Cloud9 with the plays, taking down both heroes here on this bottom lane. Very nicely done.
Man, that's the beauty of the Zeus mid. The Zeus can just offer that help and that AoE damage with the Thunder God's Wrath. Without that, they weren't going to get the second kill. They probably get the kill in the bounty, but they only get the Darkseer with the help of the Zeus ulti. So really nice play and decision-making from Cloud9 to go in, get aggressive, and this bounty pick has not worked out at all. That's the third death on Kuro, and he's level 2, and he's offered nothing to this Secret team apart from a bit of vision, but more than anything, his feeding has really been detrimental and helped out Cloud9 with this early game a lot.
Absolutely. I mean, as you were saying, CS-wise, it wasn't looking as good for Cloud9 as it was for Secret, but the fact that these kills are going their way is certainly helping even out the growth at this point. And Bone 7, maybe looking for a bit of action here between the Tier 1s and the Tier 2s, trying to look for a sneaky charge across the tree line. And I mean, Secret, they wouldn't expect it if he wants to go for it. Kuroki's actually just trying to chase down EE here with the creeps.
Bone 7 came in over the tree line from the Secret shop. One more right click, got him. Bone 7's positioning for his charges has been really good. He's managed to avoid all the observer wards, when he's gone. Like, starting from the dire jungle, starting from that secret shop, being in these positions makes it really hard to see him charging across the map.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you can kind of see why Secret banned out the Spirit Breaker in the first game. They were very aware of what could happen. Well, Kuroki and Zai, I'm going to see if they can do anything here about EE, but it's going to be very hard to catch out this PL. He's going to have a doppelganger in a second, and the Ice Shield damage is certainly sufficient, but the bottle charges from EE. Is it? Yeah, Lance gets run out as Kuroki now with the charge from Bone 7. Ah, it's going to be cancelled here. Doesn't fancy going for that return. A bit of aggression. And in the mid lane still, Arteezy in terms of farm, it's looking good. 4-2 for 2. S4 as well, we haven't really seen him do a lot. He's been given a lot of space here on this top lane. Yep. And he is sitting top of the CS at the moment.
Yeah, he'll sit safe lane normally. He'll maybe sometimes move around level 6, level 7 and use his first ulti, but this game, feeling like he's just good enough with a TP. He doesn't... I think, despite the 6-0 kill score, if you look at the CS, Secret are dominating the CS. Four of the top 6, all on their side. Puppy's free farming the jungle, he's level 4.5, so the early game has realistically gone great with the lanes for Secret, just the kills going C9's way is a bit of a problem, but they're not actually behind despite the 6-0 kill score.
Oh, they want to go for S4 here. They're going to set up with the Brain Sap. In comes the Snowball. S4 will blink away here. Well, no. The Photogos Wrath is going to be enough damage. The right kick's the Nightmare. Holding him in position. Big Daddy moves in for the final blow. And he's going to love it. But the Sonic Wave. S4's trying to turn it around. It's not quite enough. Maybe it will bring down Misery.
Deny.
And it certainly looks like it will. He's going to look for the Deny. Oh, Big Daddy. He does it. And it is a kill for the side of Cloud9. And a Deny there onto the lane. Very nice play from Cloud9 once again.
Again, the Zeus ulti just securing these kills. S4 did what he could. He blinked away, didn't actually get hit by the Snowball stun, but they were close enough to him that they had the Nightmare damage. So another kill going Cloud9's way, and that's a big one to be getting as well on Queen of Pain. So that's effectively 7-0. That one kill at the top scoreboard is not anything that really went Secret's way. And the Sonic Wave on cooldown. So now S4 can't really look to rotate and help other lanes until that Sonic Wave comes back up.
No, absolutely not. He's going to try and do his best to just to zone BDM back out of this, but no tell, this game is a very different story to what we saw from the Tusk in the first game. He's been able to be incredibly impactful. 2 kills, 3 assists so far, 8 minutes in. Now bottom lane. Looks like Secret, they want to try and find something for themselves. Arteezy is smoked up here. Kuroki leading the way. They want to do something about this EE. He's got the doppelganger, he's got the TP as well, and he will doppelganger. He's going to TP out straight away. Is he going to be able to do it? Yes, he is. Secret can't find him. He will escape, and well, meanwhile, we're going to see the side of Cloud9 get themselves kills. They bring down the Kotl. They might even be able to find S4 here as well. There's your Snowball arriving. He will fall. It's going to be 2 more kills for Cloud9. And this game, Cloud9, they're kind of walking all over Secret at this point, 9 minutes in.
Yeah, I can't believe it. Looked like Envy was just TPing in broad daylight down bottom lane, but he was fogging Secret. They had a Shuriken toss and everything to cancel the TP, but somehow just doppelganged over that little mountain at the bottom of the map, and that got him into fog.
Oh, that brings him incredibly close. They're looking for Kuroki. They also get the tower deny, though, so all in all, the defense worked out.
Yeah. Secret doing what they can to kind of find their timings, group up and pressure as they can, which, I mean, as much as they have yet to get a kill, they're actually really strong at fighting right now. They've got a level 8 Shadow Feed with his basic items and a magic wand, so he's got maxed out Razors, Queen of Pain's level 8, Darkseer's level 6. They've got kind of their core levels right now to fight, but just unable to get the objectives they wanted. The T1 tower gets denied, and everything looking decent for Cloud9 here in the early game, especially for Fata. Fata has done so much for his team, just sitting mid lane and kind of farming for the most part, but he's 3-0 and 4 with minimal rotations. Just Zeus in a nutshell right here.
Yeah, indeed, he's finding a lot. But I think it's still worth noting that for Secret, as you were saying earlier, they're still maintaining the CS advantage. I mean, 10 minutes in, let's have a look at the old net worth. How are we actually seeing that pan out? It's going to be Fata at the top, but still, even with the fact that there's a massive kill lead for Cloud9, Secret are certainly still looking healthy in terms of kind of item and level progression at this point.
Yeah, the actual gold difference between the team is around 1,000, which is next to nothing at this point. It's less than 1,000, in fact, and that's with Secret not having a single kill. That's with a 9-0 kill score between the two teams. It really goes to show that Secret, they're using Puppy more as a jungler here. We asked about whether they'd pick up a jungler for him. They effectively did when they picked up Keeper of the Light with the way he's been playing this game.
And Zed and clearing these stacks out is going to be able to bring him close to that level 6 as well. Top lane, S4. He's going to be the attention here as they're going in with the charge. He's Big Daddy. He's level 6 here. Can they do this one with a follow-up kill? Have they got enough lockdown? They're going to look for the Nether Strike. It won't be there in time. S4 will be able to blink away. But, oh, if that connected, if they could have quite easily blown up the co-op there.
Yeah, I guess the... Maybe the Netherstrike right away. The charged level 3 Sun Duration just wasn't quite enough. Didn't cut it for the kill there, unfortunately. And Secret going to be happy that they didn't give away that one. They're still looking just to continue farming their jungle stacks. Puppy and Arteezy teaming up for that. And off of that, Puppy does hit level 6 as he TP's bottom. And Puppy's going to get a huge amount of farm this game. He's just TPing around the map, blasting waves left, right, and center. And he's going to continue to be able to just provide a lot of items for his team.
Oh, a bit of a Viking off in the mid lane. We're going to see Misery going in with a Phoenix Grip onto Arteezy. Holding it still. It's actually going to be the Nightmare referred onto himself, and the Arteezy will be able to bring down the Bane with himself. There's going to be a 2-for-1 across the map there in top lane. The fight's not over. Zai, he's trying to chase this down. He's got a Sergio in the second with a Vacuum. He should be able to find BDN, and he certainly will. Gets the kill there onto the Tusk. So it's going to be a 2-for-2 across the map there between the sides.
Interesting that it looked like Kuro was trying to TP top, but then cancelled it and was able to get the Shuriken to cancel the Fiend's Grip, which meant Arteezy got the one kill at mid. But losing Arteezy on the Shadow Fiend, that's a big kill for Cloud9 to be picking up, and it's still Zeus Fata yet to go down. He's got 2.2k gold. This is either going to be a Midas or a Blink Dagger. I wouldn't mind seeing the Midas and playing for the late game, but if they want to just get aggressive and win fast, a Blink Dagger could be an option where he just starts getting super aggressive, going for kill after kill and using it for that extra mobility.
Like we're going to see by blade. 7. Just coming out to lane here with a charge onto Zai. Zai is fairly low. Does he follow this one through? He's got the hasn't got the ultimate though here. This is very deep for Bone 7 to go. They do not have the Thunder God's Wrath either. So now he's just giving him a bit of a tap and back off. But now Arteezy's coming in for the wraparound, and they might try and do something about this. And I think Bone 7, well, he might have boned a little bit too deep here. There's going to be the Vacuum, and the Rykley's coming through with the raises. They will bring down the Spirit Breaker. And just a little bit too aggressive there from the Spirit.
Yep, meanwhile, mid lane. They're going on Puppy.
War is punched into the gods, and the Thunder God's Wrath blows up the castle. They're going to look for S4 here as well, chasing him down. He will be able to blink away. Is there an ice charge? There is a few seconds. S4 contemplating turning this one around here with the ball charges, but isn't going to be able to do so. And Big Daddy, he might be in big trouble. Kuroki, he's trying to chase this one down with the slow S4. Is he going to go for it? He's still trying to deal with this sigil. And now the dust, that's going to scare Kuroki off, and Kuroki, he's going to die. Snowball comes into the final tap on the back from Big Daddy. We'll bring him down, and a lot of chaos is top lane. The fight's just continuing. Arteezy's being caught out here. He's looking to turn this one onto them, but it's not going to be enough. He goes down as well, and that's going to be Bane there taking down the SF, and this is a pretty chaotic game here, gods.
Yeah, there is. And it's a chaotic game, and Envy's just been, like, loving it. His team's dominating the early game, getting kills all over the place. I mean, I guess not dominating in the sense that they're that far ahead on gold, but when you have a Peel on your team, your early to mid game is normally pretty weak. And even the Zeus is a hero that kind of sits mid, doesn't really roam a lot, but has been able to help secure his team a ton of kills just by throwing out Thunder God's Wrath. Actually has hit level 11 already, so Fata's in a fantastic position, and when you're ahead at this stage of the game with a PL, you're looking fantastic. And Envy's just being able to sit bottom lane and farm, then he rotates top to get some more farming. With the Boots of Travel, he can even TP in to these easy lanes to go for these early pickoffs as well and help out his team a bit.
Well, look at this, top lane. There's going to be a charge onto Puppy. Puppy, he's in a lot of trouble. EE and Misery there as well. I don't think there's anywhere for this Keeper of the Light to run. The burst damage is too much, especially when, indeed, you were saying, throwing in the Thunder God's Wrath, level 11. Easy kill there for the side of Cloud9.
Yeah, they just throw that for the safety factor. If someone's sitting behind the Coddle there, they can maybe go for an additional kill, or at least they're aware of the hero's presence, so they can kind of position around the SF Razors or a Queen of Pain Sonic Wave, and they're not done. Charge mid.
And either does his pot straight away. There's your Snowball. EE teeping in with a boost of travel. Another quick pickoff there for Cloud9. Zai will come in, but he's all alone. And hang on, Arteezy. What's he trying to do? He's trying to get the Requiem off. It's going to be Doppelganger Dodge. There was an S4 Sonic Wave, but I don't think he connected onto anyone. The wall has been popped down by Zai. But again, that's not the real PL. The Sonic Cloud9 are already out of there. And a lot of things being whiffed there by Secret on the high ground.
Yeah, huge width, including the Bounty Hunter buyback. Kuro bought back for that one just to try and throw some tracks out and get his team some comeback money, which is going to be the way for Secret back in this game. This is not the way for them back in this game. S4 at mid, getting snowboard. He's getting chased down after the blink, and no tell. Finishes him off with the dunk.
And now Croaky, he could be in trouble. Do they have any kind of detection? They don't, by the look of the lightning bolt coming down. And now they're going to know where Croaky's going. He's got the other Shadow Chicken now. They're going to be charged. Now straight towards Puppy. Puppy's trying to run himself away. Arteezy getting bursted down by this Zeus. Just doing so much burst damage. Arteezy will be able to kill off the Bane. We see a wraparound now as Big Daddy comes in with a snowball onto two. He's going to be able to bring down the Cottle. There'll be a Walrus Punch onto Arteezy. He needs a bit of backup, but it looks like there's not going to be backup for him. But there will be backup for Arteezy. His eyes coming forward. He's got a surge in a few seconds. Oh, yes, indeed. Bosa with the charge. The best defense is offense, and bashing Arteezy away might be enough to buy him the time to get out. Oh, there we go, bursting them down. It's going to be an unstoppable kill streak. Vacuum onto two. Now Arteezy's getting low. He almost certainly will pop. E will be able to find the kill. Now can E get himself out? He doppelgangers, starts to run. There's going to be a surge of S4, but again, the charges from both seven, the snowballs from Big Daddy. S4 will be able to bring down the Spirit Breaker, but EE, he just kills S4 as he blinks on top of the rune. Again, Cloud9 just outplaying the side of Secret. It's 21-7. We're only 6.5 minutes in. Zai, he might be able to find the kill on TE, but no miseries there. And again, the team play from Cloud9 this game, it's just insane. They're not going to be able to kill Zai, are they? No, surely not.
Oh, maybe they are.
With the Brain Sap and the Snowball, they go in, they take down Zai as well. When's it going to stop?
That's a track kill.
Okay. That's a little bit of a cheeky one there from Puppy. But 22-8, this... What is going on, gods?
S4 and Arteezy just getting pummeled. They both have 5 deaths apiece. They're getting chased down wherever they go. The snowball, the charge. This is just face rush from Cloud9. You've got snowball charge. You've got the phantom rush from the PL to keep up. Everyone on this C9 team just with crazy mobility, and they're just using this to great effect. Andy wants to keep on fighting. He's actually picked up Dust now himself. He's saying, look, I want to be able to fight. I want to keep going for these kills. This has been better farm than actual creeps this game, just getting hero kills.
Look at this, gods. Opting to level up the Boots of Travel as his first major item of progression.
Oh, I was about to say, I was wondering where his money went. I was like, where did he go? I was clicking his hero, I didn't realize that was at level 2. Well, this to me is not an item, it's not a farming item. I mean, you farm heroes with the upgraded Boots of Travel, because you can have someone like a Spirit Breaker charging across the map, going for a kill in the enemy jungle where there's nothing to TP to, and that's where these level 2 boots allow you to join the party. You also have the Thunder God's Wrath, so there's tons of global ganky potential. Bone 7, if he goes for a charge across the map, he's got Zeus ulti and a PLTP to help him out.
Yeah, C9's global ganky potential is pretty insane. I mean, the moment on the grass, the difference is about 4k. Oh. Yeah. Oh, goodness, yeah. Oh, there's your Thunder God's Wrath. It's going to scout out this to smoke. And the TP from Fudder, do they want to try and fight into this secret? They want to still go for it. Hanging around here on the sidelines. They're going to be bringing in Artur as well. Cloud9 just being very careful here. They want to make sure that Secret don't get the jump on them here at the mid lane. Yeah,
and Secret don't mind showing that they're here. Once they get scouted by the Zeus ulti, they're just going to secure the T1 mid tower. So, not the result Secret were after, but still, Secret are really good with their smokes, because even when they don't get the kill into tower that they wanted, they still make sure they get the objective, get the tower, and use their 5-man smoke to achieve something. Not only do they get the tower, but they get some very deep observer wards down in the Radiant jungle. So they have plenty of great vision right now, and they're going to use that to try and secure Roshan. With their team fight, Vacuum, Sonic Wave, Requiem, it's really hard for Cloud9 to come and contest this one. Yeah, Cloud9 have been the one taking fight after fight, but a PL who's invested 4.5k for his boots. This is not, as much as PL can gank, he can only gank in like a 3v1 setting. He does not want to take a 5v5 fight with his current items. He wants to take like a fight where he can outnumber Secret in a small skirmish.
Yeah, and Zian's Secret here claiming Roshan. They'll be able to close back the gap that the side of C9 have created in terms of gold and XP, because it really isn't, it's not too massive at this point. It's sizable. But at this point, you know, there's still hope for the side of Secret. You look at the net worth at the moment, Arteezy, he's very close to PL's value at the moment.
I think 3,000 at this point is not that big for Secret. It's not really that much of a deficit considering we're 20 minutes in. And I'd say Secret's lineup is in a lot of ways stronger. I mean, partly because of the PL boots factor I mentioned, where you spend a lot of money on these boots that don't really allow you to teamfight that well. And also just the nature of the drafts. You've got a very teamfight-oriented 5-man lineup for Secret. On Cloud9, you're very gank and kind of pick-off-oriented. They found the ganks and pick-offs, which has got them a lead, but now Secret can group up and fight around the Aegis. This is where Secret, I think, for the next 5 minutes, while it's nighttime, they've got great vision, they have an Aegis, they're about to pick up the BKB for Arteezy. It's going to be Secret who kind of dictate play for at least the duration of this Aegis.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, the potential of the fights in terms of items definitely coming out for the side, a secret, and as you were saying, he kind of needs his next big item to be picked up before he can kind of go into these 5v5s. I mean, what do you reckon he'll pick up straight out of the boots? Do you think he'll just go straight for the defusal?
Defusal, or he goes for maybe a more fight-oriented build, which would be like a Yasha or an SMY, okay. Manta style into a BKB, but I think defusal is really good. You can purge off the Darkseer Surge. You can use it to get rid of a lot of annoying things like the Queen of Pain Orchid, if that's what... Yeah, S4's going for Orchid, so Diffusal, really good against the Orchid as well as the Surge of the Darkseer. And he's saved up quite a bit of money here, so he's not committed to anything just yet, but I think Diffusal's going to be his best option.
We're going to see them here just hiding in the trees. Yeah, they're going to know with this movement here with the Observer catching out S4, rotating down. And we'll see them back off.
Yeah, Secret deciding this is the lane they want to try and push and bring down, but the fact is C9 now recognized that there were four heroes bottom lane, so they're actually charging the Darkseer mid. They tried to catch out Zai, they knew Zai was alone, but Zai left the lane at the right time before the charge comes in and will join up with his team. Secret should be able to get this tier 2 tower uncontested, and Cloud9's plan to defend this is just split pushing. They're not going to straight up fight into Secret, they're going to force them to TP mid to defend, and Cloud9 probably won't even get this tier 2, but it's just a way of defending their high ground here. By forcing Secret back, Secret can't continue to push this bottom lane.
Indeed, and well, straight away, Bone Puppy. 7 onto Puppy. Oh, a bit of hate going on to this old man here, and he will go down with the help of the Thunder God's Wrath. And
that was really nice by Bone 7. Wow!
That was very nice as well from them there.
Finding these kills, yeah. That was a bit sloppy from Secret, TPing in, and the fact that it was nighttime, Bone 7 was just right where they were trying to TP into. Knew that Coddle likes to sit behind and just spam out that Illuminate. I think Puppy just getting a bit too cocky there with his positioning, not respecting the power of the T9 gank squad.
I mean, well, do they want to try and fight this one? They probably want to be careful. They're two heroes down, and yeah, C9 are going to actually back off, and the pink's coming out to the top tower here, maybe seeing if they can pressure another tier 2. They're going to hang around here in the Zai jungle and just decide on what the next movement's going to be, though, for the side. And yeah, it looks like this top lane's going to be a priority.
Yeah, I don't know how much they're going to be looking to... Yeah, they're probably not going to... They can't really five-man push the tower. That's where Secret just position themselves, engage in using the Darkseer Vacuum, and then followed up with the Sonic Wave, and Darkseer now with Blink and Pipe. As a great way, C9's team fight is actually awful right now. They are ahead of this game because they've executed a very hard draft to execute by finding tons of kills, tons of pickoffs, and despite the kill score being 24-8 and C9 having all these towers, it doesn't even feel like they're ahead as far as farm goes. They're, if anything, they're even, maybe with the slightest edge, but there's a lot of pressure on Envy to get a lot of items and for Fata also to build towards the late game.
Oh, we're going to see top lane. Kuroki's going to get brought back here by Puppy. And they want to go for Misery here. Solo Wall is just actually dropped by Zai. But he still picks up a blink and blinks out. They're not going to find that kill. We're going to see, BDM finding Ortiz. He's going to go with a snowball there. Has he got the backup? I mean, there's the upgraded boots here from PL, but PL's not wanting to join him. And C9 will back away. But a bit of an optimistic wall once again there from Zai.
Yeah, I guess it maybe scattered out the Bane Blink and was trying to use it to cancel the Blink Dagger of Misery. That's the only way he could really cancel the Blink and get the kill. So it would be just a Bane kill, but it's also going to be a tier 2 tower. Even without the kill, they get this tower, though, as they bring in TZ as well as S4. And they use the Aegis to get a T2 tower bottom and a T2 tower top. They didn't lose their T2 mid to the C9 push, but they did give up a couple of kills. So I think all in all, C9 are going to be really happy that they didn't lose too much to the secret five-man Aegis push, which was, I think, meant to accomplish a bit more than just two T2 towers. Mid lane.
Indeed. Oh, look at this. They found Big Daddy. He's gone a little bit big too deep. And, well, S4 with the right clicks and the soul, but there for the Orchid. They'll be able to take down the Tuscan. Blinking forward here, there's going to be the TP in. Actually coming from Arteezy. That's going to be the charge from Bone 7 going across towards the mid lane, though. S4 is going to spot him going over there as the pings come out. And it doesn't look like they'll be able to find anything more, but yeah, Tusk just got a little bit too ham there.
It's a PL blinking as well. I think more defensive than anything. S4 should have a blink out to safety, and yeah, we'll do so. Oh God, doppelganger against track. That is... that is ridiculous how you can just doppelganger and it dispels track as well. Makes it so nice for PL to play against Bounty Hunter.
It really does. 24-9. I think the interesting thing is still, though, the fact that the net worth is only a 2k lead for C9. I mean, this is really proving that Dota, it's not a game about... It's not Team Deathmatch.
Yeah, and the secret, the Bounty Hunter pick hasn't worked out. They haven't even found track kills. If they ever win a fight, suddenly it's going to be a huge gold swing in Secret's way. That's where Cloud9, their draft is super high risk. It's super volatile. If they lose a 5v5 fight, if they take a 5v5 fight, chances are they're losing it because they're fighting into Pipe and this huge teamfight wombo combo. But for now, it's been perfect C9 play. They have to keep it up, though. That's where it's, I looked at these drafts and said Secret have a much better draft, because Cloud9 have a draft where one mistake, one bad teamfight, and they just lose the game.
Oh. Look at Misery. He's a little bit all alone here. The Orca's going to come out. Kuroki's looking for that track hold, and he'll certainly find it there. And these are the kills that we're talking about. If they can find these track kills, the side of Secret will quite easily be able to close that 2k gap at this point in the game.
Yeah. I mean, Secret, if they wanted to get greedy there, could have even waited for, like, the Darkseid to blink in for some track money himself, but it's all good here. Secret get one track kill and continue to farm up their core heroes, and that's where, for C9, they're going to play for... At this point, it's going to be probably Secret with control over this game for the duration. They should be able to secure next Roshan. The next 10-15 minutes are going to be really good for Secret, but if it drags out too long, that's where you get to that really scary late-game Zeus and late-game PL status. They're not really there yet. Fata needs... probably we'll see a Refresher Orb come out for him. We'll see maybe an Aghanim Scepter, a Veil, whatever it may be. And PL probably needs, I would say, two more items on top of the Diffusal. PL wants a Skadi plus maybe a Manta Style before he's really ready to go that late game mode. He needs not just the one Diffusal Blade, not even one more item. He needs to be super tanky and dish out a lot of damage to be able to fight our TZ Shadow Fiend.
And the, I mean, yeah, we're still after that kill as well. It goes down about over 1,000 gold and it really is hitting back to zero. It kind of feels that, I mean, could C9 have done more with that early game momentum? And do you feel that the upgraded boots of travel were the best item pickup for EE?
I think it's more just like a, hey, if kills show themselves, I'll take them. There's no item he can really buy at that price point for 2,000 gold.
Yes.
Or
yeah.
I guess he spent 4,000 gold on the upgrade boots. Even if he had like a Diffusal Treads with a Vit Booster or a Yasha at that point, it doesn't allow him to teamfight, because Secret, just by pure hero composition, have the better team fight. There's no way PL can itemize that will change that. So PL has to just go for this global farming build, as well as just maybe you can get a gank hero there, you can help your team get a kill. You can also split push and play for a 45-50 minute game. As much as this patch has been about 25 minute games, C9 have been playing this game as if they're hoping that it goes 40-50-60 minutes. Despite looking to dominate and get tons of early kills, at no point were they looking to end the game fast. They haven't tried grouping up and pushing towers. Their draft just doesn't do that.
Oh, bottom lane, S4. He needs to be careful. Fada here, he's positioning himself with an inventory, and there's going to be a TP back from Bane, and, well, S4, he's going to start to go, but here comes your greater boost of travel in action here. Should be able to find the kill on S4. Oh, the blink again. He's going to TP out. He's going to be able to find it. No! Fada will be able to get him there with the final arc lightning, so very nicely caught out there, C9, and, well, here we go. C9, they might find more. Kuroki's going to lose the TP away, but the snowball's going to be there to cancel it. He's going to be stuck here. Big Daddy will try and chase this down, and Fata, again, coming in with the lightning. It's going to be a double kill for the Zeus, and Secret throwing away a couple of two sloppy kills there.
Yeah, this just plays into C9's draft. This is all their draft does, is find pickoffs and then farm, farm, farm. And this is, when you find pickoffs, it's a lot easier to farm, because you're so much safer on the map with Bounty and Quap dead, and C9 not done, going for some more kills, but
against
charged, and... Ooh, Fiend's Grip got cancelled, though, and with that, I think C9 going to be pushed back.
Look at this body block here from Zai, trying to do it again, but now he's turned up at the same time. Arteezy comes in with a Requiem of Souls, but it's just on the edge of pretty much nothing. The fight's continuing here. They have been able to bring down Bone 7. There's going to be the Surge onto Arteezy, but actually a Darksea Illusion there blocking him. At the same time, EE is trying to find Puppy, but he's going to go the wrong way, and it will just end up with Bone 7 dying there in that engagement. And at the same time, 29 minutes in, Fardy, he's got his Refresher Orb finished now on top of the Bloodstone and Blink Dagger.
Yeah, nicely juked by Puppy. Got away from Envy there, but I think C9 maybe getting a bit too aggressive there with Queen of Pain and Bounty Hunter dead. Arteezy did use a BKB charge, which if you're playing for that 60-minute game, which realistically C9 are, having this BKB down to a low duration is very important when you have a Zeus on your side. Zeus kind of goes through this period where around like 30 to 45 minutes, he's not that strong because everyone has these long duration BKBs. But once you get to the ultra late game, Zeus is incredible. He's got percent-based damage from Static Field, which is really good against six-slotted carries who get super tanky, and also great against the 5-second BKBs. Once you get tanky enough so that you can stay alive and just kite around the BKBs and then dish out a ton of damage on Zeus, this hero really picks up steam in the late game, and that's something we're going to see if Secret can't take enough objectives here, probably during this next Aegis. I feel like Secret need to get a lot done during this next Roshan and Aegis timing that they're going to have.
Oh, they walk straight into Misery. Misery just not aware what's going on. He'll get taken down. That's going to be a track kill for the side of Secret. And the smoke was certainly successful there, getting themselves some more gold. And at this point, any track kill is going to be a good kill. There's Bone 7 with the Shadow Blade charging in onto S4 with the ult as well, trying to hold him in place. He is moving in. The Thunder Ghost Ref as well, and with the Snowball Lockdown, they will bring down the Queen of Pain. There's going to be the wall dropped again, but it's another wall that just doesn't really accomplish a lot. The side of C9 just walking away. They will find the kill onto Big Daddy No Tail. Envy, he's sticking about. He's very low on mana here. Bone 7 just charging himself out of the fight. He will top a Kanga, but the Blink 4 from the side. And now Zai's looking for the play. There's going to be a Diffusal Blade slowing him down, but they're trying to find this kill on E. He's so low. The Blink 4 from Arteezy, they'll be able to secure it. It's a double kill for the Shadow Fiend. And in that fight, I mean, you were talking about when these team fights kick off and they get the track gold.
Yeah.
That was a lot of track gold going the way of Secret.
Oh, yeah. All track kills. Three track kills in a row. And Arteezy's itemized really smart this game. It's the mobility that's been a problem for Secret. Cloud9 have all these charges and global spells with the Zeus, the charge, the snowball, the PL doppelganger, and he said, okay, I'm gonna get mobility myself. Picks up Boots of Travel and Blink Dagger, has double boots going on, but this Boots of Travel and especially the Blink Dagger, very important for keeping up with Cloud Knights in these chaotic teamfights. So really good job by Secret with the itemization on Arteezy, and they're clawing their way back in this game. Those track kills get them back to dead even on the net worth graph.
Now that's actually ticked in a bit more now. It's 2K back the way of Secret.
Oh,
so.
Wow.
Yeah, Cloud9, they need to be careful. You know, one more fight like that, and Secret, they're going to have more of a lead against the side of Cloud9 than Cloud9 have had at all this game, 32 minutes in. And you know, Thunder God's Wrath comes out. It will give them the intel that Secret are indeed doing Roshan. But Secret, they don't look to be scared at all. They're going to stand their ground. They've got the wall back up in 10 seconds. It's going to be very hard for Cloud9 to contest this, and it doesn't look like they're even going to try at this point.
I don't think they can. They just, again, the hero composition doesn't allow it. For C9, it's going to be about defending high ground against the Aegis push, finding pickoffs where you can, and split pushing where possible as well. And that's where Envy needs to keep on farming, getting more items for himself. He's going to be going for a Manta style Nexus, picked up the recipe as well as a Yasha. So I think a Manta Skadi. Skadi just seems like a better version of Heart of Tarrasque as far as HP and survivability goes, and also allows you to teamfight a bit better. And then at some point, he's going to have to be forced to 5v5 fight, and the only way I think he does so is even throwing in a Satanic in the mix. He needs the lifesteal to be able to match up to the Shadow Fiend. So he needs a lot. This needs to be a six-loaded PL. I mean, I'm listing off like tier 4 item after tier 4 item. He needs it all this game, so Envy just going to have to keep on split pushing and timing.
That vacuum there, stopping the Bone 7 charge. Oh
nice
my goodness. Oh my. Oh, that was beautiful. That was quite something. Very nice to know. Secret, I mean, again, they're finally, that was a track kill as well. That was a track kill.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that they've got this gem on Darkseer, enabling this them to catch out the Bone 7 charges. I gotta be honest, it's looking a bit rocky for Cloud9 now, gods.
And that's where every Secret kill, it's like a 1,000 gold swing. C9, throughout the early game, getting pickoffs, it was maybe like 400 gold going their way per kill. That's just where Secret, I don't even feel like they were ever behind this game. They had the early game definitely went worse than they would normally hope for, but at no point were they actually struggling or losing this game.
Indeed, let's have a look at the graphs now as that's ticked in. And yeah, so it's coming into 3k in terms of gold XP as well. It's returning to zero. But at the same time, they still do have this PL. But he's not really been able to do that much this game after his very successful early game.
He's playing keep away. He was top initially for that. Then he TP bottom, and he wants to make sure he avoids any ganks as much as possible. I mean, that's Cloud9 as a whole. They're just playing as far away back as possible, using the Zeus ulti for scouting information. We see him throw it out there, and that allows Misery on the Bane almost to find a pickoff. Darkseer almost got caught alone there in the jungle, but as soon as the Zeus ulti came out, he used that blink to get back to safety.
I mean, the Manta style is complete now onto EE, so he's going to be a bit more stronger in these fights. But at the same time, big items coming out for Secret. S4's got his BKB. Butterfly is now complete on Arteezy, sitting at the top of the graph.
It's
Cloud9 or Secret?
Secret. They've got Aegis, they've got Butterfly. They're going to go for a high ground siege, at least to force C9 to defend, because if C9 have to get forced to defend, maybe they get baited into like a 5v5 team fight.
Let's see what they do here. Arteezy, he's on the top lane, standing tall, and Puppy's going to be down the sidelines, the side of Cloud9. Do they want to try and do something about this? Secret, Kuroki, and S4, they're actually wrapping around towards the top as well, so it looks like Secret want to fight. There's going to be mass TPs out there from the side of Cloud9 as they do not want to stick about here. And it looks indeed that they will retreat.
You never know. This is like a C9 classic. You just hide in trees and you're just plenty. Yeah, there we go. Misery blinks even further away. So this is something which some teams even start checking for. It's just like start breaking down trees, blinking in, checking and scouting things out. But Secret have 2 minutes left on this Aegis. So if they want to go for that high ground push, it needs to happen soon. Seems that Zai still farming very deep in the jungle, is not going to join up with this team just yet. And I mean, Secret just need to start massing boots of travel. I could see Darkseer getting some, even Puppy maybe wants some on the Keeper of the Light. They have great global movement with the recall, and that's where Puppy, if he can get some boots of travel, can offer a lot to his team.
And here we go, actually, to back towards the mid lane, bringing people back here. EE taking down the Ancients. And just going to be Artur here on this top lane on his own. But I mean, yeah, at this point, do you feel... Can Secret, do they have to pile on the aggression, or are they going to be comfortable with just taking the game later? Or is there always this imminent threat of the PL getting very scary?
Their late game's still good. I don't feel like they lose late game. There's a charge bottom lane. Bones haven't realized it's a bad fight. Envy actually TP'd it as well. Uh-oh, Envy orked it up. There's a track soon, and this looks like the death of the PL. Mana leak also a problem for him. Secret.
Oh, boy.
Can go late game. And the big thing is here, they've just been trying to bait C9 into those kind of plays. Just previously, when they had Arteezy pushing top lane and had three heroes mid, they were pretending that they had four heroes top. They were like, okay, we'll show Arteezy top. If he's top, C9 are going to assume we're camping behind Arteezy, using him as bait. But they were using him as bait in a different way. They had him top, hoping to find a pick off mid. Instead, they find the pick off bottom. By showing one hero in the Shadow Fiend, very deep pushing a lane, it leads Cloud9 to think that these pickoffs elsewhere on the map are safe. And that was far from safe as they charged in bottom lane.
Yeah, indeed. In Secret, they're already trying to push up the high ground. 38 seconds still on the clock for this PL. Cloud9, they're going to try and do their best to stem the aggression from Secret, but the pipe's been popped out. Arteezy just heading up there, bashing down as this tier 3.
He just gone.
And Fighter trying to do what he can. They're looking to force a fight. Bone 7 going in. They've got a feast grip onto Arteezy, but the Sonic Wave catches them all. Now Zai coming in with the Shiva's Guard. It's going to be two heroes down. Arteezy will buy back straight away. And he, of course, does have those boosts of travel to get himself back into the fight. And there we go. No, he doesn't even need it. Puppy just calls him in. And at this point, it's not looking great for Cloud9. They're almost certainly going to lose a set of racks. There's no fortification available. Bottom racks will fall. The Fenugos Raps are coming out. Big Daddy looking for the wraparound with the Rush Punch. Will be able to bring down Bounty Hunter, but Arteezy just pops the BKB in the Requiem. They'll take down the Tusk, and they get the melee racks there from the bottom lane, and Secret, they're able to get themselves back out without losing too much at all.
Normally when your Shadow Fiend dies, the second after his Aegis expires, the fight goes horribly wrong, but Arteezy just buys back. They win the fight even with the SF dying. Like, SF died before the fight had even begun there, but it didn't really even matter for Cloud9. They didn't have their PL was the big thing there, and PL not having buyback after that death bottom just set up so much damage onto the C9 base. They had all kinds of problems defending without PL. He's very important for their team fight just because of how much damage and survivability he has. He's one who just needs to be in there playing these scrappy fights. And yeah, they kill the SF, but anything that happened after that was still just a train wreck for C9.
Indeed, and Darkseer Zai, I mean, his farm, it's been pretty incredible. He's third on the net worth, and he's got himself the good old Octarine corner on top of the Shiva's Pipe and Blink.
Yeah, this is a lot of farm coming his way. Darkseer going to have some very short cooldown. I would say, importantly, a short cooldown on the pipe, as well as the vacuum wall. But the pipe short cooldown really helps a lot against Zeus. But yeah, the vacuum wall also really nice to have the short cooldown on as well.
Indeed, and Secret looks like they're ready to join group up here and go for more. They've already taken down all the tier 2s. They're ready to try and break into the base and take down another set of racks. And at the moment, Misery and Big Daddy just sitting down here on their own. They need to be careful if Secret get wind of this. They'll certainly look to try Secret and jump in. Bone 7 moving in as well. They're ready to defend their Cloud9, but they do have the PL this time. So hard. Maybe they can give it a better shot. Yeah.
Yeah, they have these heroes who just don't team fight well. The Spirit Breaker, single target. Big Daddy, no tail, mostly single target. The Sigil gets easily brought down. The Snowball, you don't really want to be snowballing into a fight. You kind of do to the extent where you want to try and hit as many heroes as possible with the Snowball stun, but there's no real damage coming from either Tusk or Spirit Breaker. The Bane's not getting off, isn't really able to get off good Fiend's Grip, so it's entirely dependent on Zeus as well as PL in these team fights to dish out huge amounts of damage. Fata is going to have an Octarine Core soon, which will help out some of his problems dishing out damage. He'll have shorter cooldowns on all his spells. He'll be able to spam out a lot more, but it's still going to be rough. It's still going to be very Secret favored in any team fights moving forward.
Here we go, Secret. They're smoked up. Arteezy leading the way. He's going to find Misery again. Blinks forward. And now S4 with the silence of the Big Daddy Hotel. Bone 7 pops the BKB. Tries going, but Arteezy and S4, they've already popped their BKBs. That's going to be the first kill, bringing down Big Daddy. They're trying to chase down Bone 7. Vacuum will catch out. He's trying to top gang himself away. But S4, he's already on the front lines. The track is onto Bone 7. The dagger is one. Now with the Requiem blowing them up. That's two kills. Make that three kills as EE falls as well. And again, this is a situation where the Phantom Lancer, he's down for 80 seconds and he doesn't have buyback gods.
Neither does Spirit Breaker. They also conveniently have a creep wave mid, so they can just go high ground instantly. And this is going to be a second lane of Rakdos. It looks like C9 could be down four Rakdos here, and their tournament lifeline is currently disappearing quickly.
There'll be a buyback from Big Daddy. The fortification will come out. But Secret, they're going to be happy just standing here on the high ground. Oh, the silence, the light, bringing fighter back. He's too tanky for them to bring down, but they'll certainly give him the bit of the shivers, and here we go. There's your third first Thundergross Wrath. And now Big Daddy coming in with a snowball. They're trying to do something here onto S4. Can they bring anyone down, though? S4's going to be able to blink away. There's a Fiend's Grip onto Zai. Misery, they'll just be popped away here by Puppy. And now the Nightmare onto Misery. Actually, it attempted to be a defensive one, but it's actually going to spell disaster for him as BKB's popped by Arteezy. He just takes down the Bane. They've already taken down the melee racks in the mid lane. Ranged racks are going to almost certainly go down here as well. Gems on the deck. And Cloud9, they're just falling apart. Bone 7 will charge in now. He wants to find something desperately, going for Puppy here. Can he kill the Cottle? That's the big question. It doesn't look like he can. He goes in with an Everstrike. They've lost S4 here on the side of Secret, but now the Shuriken Bounce is coming through. They take down Big Daddy. Zai now on a dominating kill streak. Arteezy just casually TPs himself out. And here we go. It's, again, another team fight. The Secret, they're coming out on top. They might lose Zai off the back of it. Diffuser Blade coming out. He's trying to go in, but he needs to be careful here. He can't die again. It's going to be disastrous for Cloud9. He will just doppelganger himself away. And Secret, they just don't want to leave the base. They're happy hanging around here.
Arteezy TP's home and gets recalled back in. He is 100% uptime, this hero. And now Envy is about to die again. This will be it if they lose the PL. And with the vacuum back, Envy gets pulled in, healed up by the Bloodstone, but it's not going to be enough for him. Or is it? Zai? One last Darkseer punch brings him down, and that's game over.
Wow. I mean, this was a game that we were, what, 16 minutes in or something, and it was 22-8 for Cloud9.
Yeah, even earlier that it was like 10-1 or something, or 10-0. Yeah.
Well,
it was Cloud9, it was weird. I think there was some, like, to me, their draft kind of lacked that synergy. They had these very late game oriented heroes in Zeus as well as PL, but then they had Tusk as well as Spirit Breaker, who are more early to mid game oriented. So they never really had this timing where they could fight that well with the PL.